You're listening to My Favorite Show, where Dr. Richard Call and Greg Riccardi discuss the matters that matter most. Join the conversation by calling 800-962-1160. And now, Dr. Call and Greg Riccardi of My Favorite Show.
Okay, Greg Riccardi here, My Favorite Show. I'm your host, and normally I have a co-host. And, for all of those of you who may not remember who he is, I'm just kidding. It's Dr. Richard Call. Excuse me? Okay, so, sorry, we had a little technical glitch there. All right, so basically, normally Dr. Call is with me on the show. He's not, believe it or not, he has to deal with some traffic tickets, believe it or not, at court. So I'm going to be flying solo tonight, and we're going to have a good time, right? So we are fortunate enough to have a guest with us. His name is Kevin Rex of Summit Financial. And he's actually sitting right here, normally in Dr. Call's desk. So I'm going to say, how you doing?
Hey, Kevin. Greg, how are you?
Good. So finance and money and your financial health and your retirement and things like that, all very important topics. If all of those are, all your bases are covered in that area, then maybe you want to double or triple what you have. Maybe you have some goals you want to take care of. So let's start off by just finding out a little bit who you are, what you do. We can go from there. And by the way, folks, a couple things before we do that. Sorry, Kevin.
Yeah.
We have a website associated with our show. It's called myfavoriteshow.com. And if you cannot listen, if you're out of the area and you can't listen live, you can go to myfavoriteshow.com. There's a listen live button right there on the first page. You can listen live on any device, whether it's your computer or your laptop, anything like that. So go there. You can sign up for email alerts and text reminders about the shows that are coming up. To send us a message by text, you want to text MFS to 313131. MFS 313131. Now, what that'll do is you just put your name in there, put your question, and we'll try to get it on the air. Of course, you can call 800-962-1160 to ask your question directly. And there was one more thing I was going to say. That's it. No, we're good. All right, so Kevin, tell us a little about who you are, what you do, and we'll start there.
Sure. Well, Greg, let me just start by saying that financial life today has become so complex as compared to years ago. Our parents, our grandparents grew up in a generation where they worked, they had pensions, they had a strong Social Security system. The financial products were not so vast as they are today. They were not as complicated, nearly as complicated as they are today. Today, instead of having a pension, most people have 401ks.
Yep.
You're on your own to choose the investments. You're on your own to figure out how much is enough. When you worked under a pension, you retired with, let's say, 75% of your pay, and with Social Security, you figured that was enough, and the math was done for you.
Right.
But today, it's very complex.
Yeah.
There's well over 5,000 mutual funds out there.
Huh.
There's over 5,000 hedge funds. Not to mention all the annuity and insurance products. And different tax strategies. The tax laws are more complicated than they ever were, and the world is globalized.
Yeah.
So a lot of the financial products, you have to know what you're doing interstate and sometimes internationally.
Right.
So it's become a very complex world. Well, that being said, I'm a principal at Summit Financial, and we have a firm that basically is built to deal with this complexity.
Right.
Whether it's doing the high-end analysis, or whether it's having a back office staff that's comprised of professionals from four disciplines.
Yep.
Law, taxes, insurance, and investments. Mind you, we're not lawyers to our clients nor CPAs, but we don't represent our clients, but we have those kinds of professionals back office, so that when we give advice, we give it You know, we think across those four disciplines and consider everything and how it's intertwined.
Right, right. So how various aspects of the law of taxes, et cetera, will impact whatever decisions you're making.
Correct. So we're giving full strategic and, you know, doing full strategic planning so that, again, we're considering all the what-ifs.
Sure, sure. Yeah. So you mentioned a bunch of different vehicles, annuities and hedge funds and all this kind of stuff.
Yes.
When, what percentage of people would you say, and I realize this is just a total guess out there, but for someone who is, let's say, 30 to 65, mm-hmm. what are most people, after they're paying their bills and maybe saving something, what are they using? Is it like vast majority 401k, or what would you say? I mean, if you could.
Yeah, the most commonly used savings instrument for retirement is the modern day 401k. You know, people will tend to try to participate at least to max out the company match.
Right.
Okay? But then they're on their own to pick investments, and very often they default to what's called lifestyle funds. And mm-hmm. lifestyle funds are where the, let's say a mutual fund family or the vendor who sponsors the 401k will actually, based on your age, build a portfolio for you.
Okay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that the lifestyle funds, of course, there's a fee for that, and it's built into the funds.
Okay.
So they're not necessarily inexpensive.
Right.
Okay. But, you know, it is a way to, if you know nothing about investments
mm-hmm.
and just don't feel you have a level of competency, that is a way to, you know, have the vendor do it for you, you know.
Right, right, right.
Yeah.
So, lifestyle fund. Now, again, I mean, it's okay, you didn't, but like are most people in 401ks?
Yeah.
50%, would you say? I mean, just to throw it, you know, doesn't really matter.
I don't have statistics on it, but sort of in my world is more of the, you know, upper middle class, if not, you know, high net worth sort of world. Yes, I mean, the vast majority of people are participating and maxing 401ks and then doing catch-ups.
Right.
After 50 years old, you're allowed to even put more money into a 401k. So they're also maxing out with what's called catch-ups. The 401k, I would say, is probably the most utilized financial strategy out there.
Sure.
With regard to saving for children's education, of course, I believe the 529 plans would also be a very popular mechanism.
Sure.
The 529 plans are an opportunity to save through the use of mutual funds with tax deferral and
right.
tax-free withdrawal, providing the money is used for education.
And how do they check that? I mean, is it they issue the check to the financial to the education institution?
Yeah, on the back end, when that invoice comes for little Johnny's tuition,
right.
You can work it two ways. You can pay it and then show proof of payment,
right.
and they'll reimburse you, or you can send them the invoice and they'll pay it directly.
Gotcha,
yeah,
gotcha.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
So, if you know you were sitting at a you know bar restaurant or you know down to dinner with somebody, and someone were to say you know what's going on in general out
yep.
there,
yep.
like what's the economic climate? What should people be concerned about if anything?
Mm-hmm.
How would you say the climate is right now for investing and saving?
Well, I think more so than ever. As I said, financial life is becoming more complex, and there are probably more concerns now than there ever were in terms of your money lasting you. Let me mention a few. For instance, you save money in a 401k, and I guess we all kind of think, well, I don't want my money to run out before I'm, let's say, I don't know, 80, 85. That's kind of the mindset of most people. But with technology advancing and being as exponential in advancement as it is,
mm.
you know, in our lifetimes, we can certainly see a situation where life expectancies would go way up. So
right.
those who saved and now run out of money at age 80 may be needed to save till age 95 or 100.
Okay.
Yeah.
That music indicates we have to take a break, and we will do so after these commercial messages. We'll see you on the other side. And we're back. This is Greg Riccardi, your host of My Favorite Show, here having a very exciting conversation with Kevin Rexo of Summit Financial. We want to remind you that if you have questions for Kevin, feel free to call in 800-962-1160. We're ready to take your calls and ask any questions you'd like. So before the break, we were talking about 401ks and that kind of thing.
Yes.
Let me, from a step back type of thing. Let's say hypothetically, I inherited some money, or I just maybe have a chunk of money that I haven't done anything with for a long time. Yep. Kind of been building it up. Like, what would you say would be a good, in general? Obviously, you don't know my specific, circumstances. I'm sure that plays into it. But in general, what would you say is the best way to go, if you could, write a book to somebody that's generic?
Sure. Yeah. Well, let's say, first off, I've analyzed your liquidity and cash flow. Okay? Mm-hmm. And we've set a risk tolerance. Okay. And we would certainly want to preface all your investment recommendations by doing the analysis first.
Okay.
Yeah. But now, let's say I have an excellent understanding of what money you have coming in, what money you have going out, what your need for money is, mm-hmm. And now we're building a portfolio. Okay.
Okay.
The first thing we would do is look to diversify. The portfolios we build are extremely diversified. Okay, it's almost mandatory in today's environment. The swings with hedge fund trading and the kind of volume that comes into the market, regularly through 401ks, the swings in the market are huge.
Okay, right.
And to make bets and focus on
short term.
It's not only short term, but to focus on just niches and crannies of the market, without being broadly diversified, is extremely risky.
Sure.
Okay, by today's standards.
So no matter, let's say you sit down with someone and you determine that their, risk tolerance is low, medium, or high, no matter what they say, you're going to diversify.
We're still going to diversify,
uh-huh.
Yes. What we do is we first off break out an asset allocation. Not at this point even picking the investment, but picking the investment classes.
Right,
the type of investments we
want
to be in. So we'll sort out, for instance, an asset allocation by type, and that is, how much money should we have in cash?
Right.
Okay.
That's the first priority?
Well, yeah, making sure you always have that cash liquidity.
Okay.
And then how much money should be in fixed income or bonds, basically.
Okay.
Then we'll look at how much should be in domestic stocks, how much should be in international stocks, and then how much should be in alternative investments.
Okay.
We want to always make sure that we have zig and zag built into the portfolio.
Which means what?
We want assets that do not behave like each other.
I see. So.
And every time we build a new investment into a portfolio, we want to work closer and closer to efficient frontier. And that means that every investment behaves differently than the other.
Right.
Okay. And that builds your broad diversification, which then in turn hedges risk.
Gotcha.
Okay. So, again, we'll work out, what should be in, fixed income versus equities. On the equities, the domestic stocks versus international, you've got to be very careful today to even hedge your currency bets. That's why you do want some international in the portfolio. Even within the fixed income,
mm-hmm.
you want domestic and you want international, to hedge your risk.
Now, fixed income, what is that?
That's bonds. That's basically bonds,
okay.
Real estate, non-equities.
Those are the safest vehicles?
Well, cash is always the safest, but fixed income would be the next rung up on the risk ladder, and then equities would be the next rung, and depending on what alternative investments you invest in, they could be as risky as bonds or riskier than stocks and anywhere in between.
Right.
Depending on what you're investing in.
Gotcha. Yep. So as you're mentioning all this, I'm kind of picturing in my head almost like a breakout of a structure.
Right.
So you've got X amount of dollars. Then you break that out into the type.
Yeah.
Okay, we want so much in this, so much in that, et cetera.
Right.
Then you said, I think for a second ago, something about, when something acts a certain way within that that class of
or right.
type of product.
Right.
You make decisions based on
yes.
on that, right?
Yes. So we want correlating and non-correlating investments.
Okay.
We want ones that will move with the market, generally speaking. Why? Because the market generally has gone up historically.
Right.
You know, pretty much any you know double-digit year time frame. You know, I think barring, what was it? 98 to 08, I think was the only exception. Every 10-year time frame, the equities markets have gone up.
Okay? Right.
So we know the markets, generally speaking, if your time frame is long enough, have gone up.
Okay? Yeah.
The you know of course you can lose a whole lot of money while the market goes up if you're not diversified and you're not hedged.
Okay? Right. Right.
So the key is that diversification, building in that non-correlation, hedging the portfolio for the various contingencies. You want to be hedged against inflation. You want to be hedged against the currency risk.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you want to produce income if you're a retiree. So, by the way, another thing we would look at is the attribute of the investment. What needs to be in safety of principal? In other words, what money will you absolutely not put at risk?
Right.
And on top of that, you may need to produce income on the portfolio. So
yeah.
How much income do you want to derive from this portfolio?
As you're saying that, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to.
Yeah.
I'm picturing myself, I'm at the blackjack table, and I'm
right,
like,
right.
I got three columns of things, or 10, and I'm like, how much do I want to put on the line?
Right.
So, okay. It's
well, you know,
we
do that for our clients, though. That's why we run the cash flows.
Uh-huh.
We let them know, for instance, you know, if you never lose this money, this should be enough to retire on.
Okay.
And, you know, the rest of it could now be a hedge for inflation and things like that. But, you know, we try to carve out,
right,
you know, some absolute line in the sand where you're in low-risk investments and you're not jeopardizing your retirement.
Gotcha.
By the same token, you certainly want to hedge inflation. I mean, it's, I think I was talking just a moment ago on, you know, some of the things that can go wrong. You know, one is open-ended life expectancy, which I guess you can consider a good thing.
What does that mean?
But for we were talking about it before. You think you might live to 80 or 85,
right?
And you live to 100. Well, you know, your money just has to last you now 15 years longer than you were planning on.
Right.
Okay?
Or have lots of kids. Exactly.
You know, also inflation. Inflation could tear apart a portfolio.
Right.
Okay, it can deteriorate it. So you really need to have a portfolio that balances out inflation. Okay.
So how many people in your firm?
About 300.
300, okay. Yeah. That's sizable. So how does it work in terms of internally? So are there people working on, you know, this asset class for me and that asset class, if something happens, you know, who's monitoring everything? Is it broken out into, you know?
It's broken out into various teams. Like, for instance, we run model portfolios.
Mm-hmm.
So we have people that run the models. We have an investment committee that oversees our investment philosophy and meets regularly. We have experts at the office that have, you know, their area of expertise, whether it's the lawyers doing estate planning or whether they're, you know, our accountants and tax attorneys looking at the tax ramifications of the investments. We also have, obviously, some people who can drill down deep on insurance and investment products. And then within my personal staff, you know, people who deal with my clientele, you know, I have, you know, several tenured professionals
mm-hmm.
from good schools. And we're talking MIT, Notre Dame, and including I have a doctorate in economics on staff. So I have a good group on staff.
Right.
That, you know, if I'm out of the office for a moment, they certainly know what they're talking about if a client calls in.
Gotcha.
With a question. So it's kind of like I have an immediate team
mm-hmm.
that deals only with my clients, and then Summit Financial, the parent firm, you know, has a group of back office technical professionals.
Oh, I see. So
that can drill down deep as well.
Oh.
You know, for the firm and all the firms. Products and relationships.
I see. So is it that Summit Financial is kind of behind a group of, when you say 300, are you all in one building or that's not that?
Well, we have a few offices. I would say most of us are in the main office in person.
Okay,
yeah.
Cool. We have a text that came in from Tom from Bogota, and he asks, what philosophy does one need to invest properly today? Yeah, what philosophy, yeah. Yep. What philosophy, I mean, is there a guiding principle, a philosophy, or a, maybe an attitude that, or belief system that you need to be a good investor?
Yeah. Well, I think first of all, you have to be careful with the offering of products today, because some have, as you probably know, very high fees, and some have very low fees. Low fee doesn't necessarily always mean good, and high fee bad, but you got to be very careful. You certainly have to control your costs, control your investment costs.
Mm-hmm.
We have access to the mutual fund universe at what's called NAV, which is just the pure cost of the mutual fund without commissions and loads. Okay? But the typical investor, you know, can have their portfolio just eaten apart with fees, okay? Whether they're loads or whether they're, you know, hidden commissions or mm-hmm. just high internal costs of the funds even. Okay?
Yeah.
So first thing is control your investment costs. The second is obviously taxes can mm-hmm. tear apart a portfolio.
Yep.
So you want to invest as tax efficiently as possible. If I can structure something that saves you 20-30% on taxes, well, that's going to be better than any return I show you.
Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So you certainly want to be very tax efficient. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And then last but not least is diversification. Like we were talking by type, by attribute of the asset, by building in non-correlation,
mm-hmm.
correlating and non-correlating asset classes. So that sort of matrix, if you will,
right,
of diversification, so that you have that zig and zag I referred to in the portfolio,
yeah,
you know, with different parts moving in different directions, responding to current events differently.
True.
So this is, you know, we did a great job back in 08, you know, and back in 01, 02 when markets imploded. I remember inheriting a brokerage house portfolio that because of not only the market imploding, the whole portfolio was in technology stocks. It was also on margin.
Right.
Okay. And it was heavily laden with preferred stocks. And these things got absolutely crushed back in 01, 02. The client had lost 80%.
And this is before.
No, they came to me and they got referred to me. And I looked at the old portfolio. I could not believe it. The client had lost 80% of his portfolio. So, you know. You know, you have to be very careful of things like this. You know, brokerage houses, you know, they don't explain perhaps the risk many times when you do things like go on margin. Okay, you have to be, you know, very careful not to get caught. And this would be the fourth thing, not to get caught in to just bad ideas, bad products, bad concepts.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, on the other side of the break, we'll talk about what those bad concepts are that an experienced or inexperienced investor might want to avoid. And we're going to go to a break now. Again, Greg Riccardi here at My Favorite Show, speaking with Kevin Rex of Summit Financial. Thanks. We'll see you on the other side of the break. And we're back. I'm Greg Riccardi here with My Favorite Show, speaking with Kevin Rex of Summit Financial. We're talking about all things money, all things financial, and we want to remind you, call in with your questions, because we know you all have burning questions out there. 800-962-1160, or you can text your questions in to text MFS to 313131 and put your question after it, and we'll get it on the air. So we have a text from Kelly T. from Paramus. She wants to know what a financial plan consists of.
Sure.
Sound like a cash register there.
Well, you know, when I do a financial plan for a client, you know, we look at several areas. The first is the estate plan. You know, what do you have or not have with regard to things like wills and trusts and living wills and powers of attorney, and how are the assets owned? How are your beneficiary designations set up? It's very complicated. You know, in the United States, there's a potential state inheritance tax, depending on the state,
mm-hmm.
and then there's a federal estate tax. Okay, it constantly gets recodified; it's moved around. Right now, the threshold for federal estate taxation is approximately $5.4 million, so it's very robust. But some of the states tax at much lower levels, $600,000, $1 million, depending on the state. So
are they taxed if you have someone that the money's going to?
Yes.
You know, like your wife or your, you know, that kind of thing?
Yes.
Still taxed?
Yeah, you're still taxed. The European system is different. You pay less tax if the money's going to your direct children. In the United States, they just care about the size of the estate at death. It doesn't really matter who it's going to so much as how much is there.
Right. Okay?
But, you know, making sure you have all the I's dotted and T's crossed. I have to tell you, you know, when clients come to me, even having done wills with, you know, reputable law firms, you know, we make so many corrections, even to the document itself, let alone the enhancements on the estate plan itself.
Now, you're recommending these enhancements for the actual attorneys to do it, right? You said you don't.
No, we don't. Yeah, we don't practice law. What we do is we make recommendations on building out the estate plan.
And someone would need a lawyer to actually execute.
Yeah, you would go to an attorney, one that the client may have a relationship, perhaps one that we might refer.
Right.
Okay, but you'd have to have a representing attorney.
Okay. Yeah. And why is it's interesting that you know your estate after you die, you know, that's the ultimate end game, obviously.
Right.
But that is the first thing you look at? I mean,
well, no, amongst others. No, there's no particular order. No.
Okay.
But for instance, another thing that I think is the bedrock of a good financial plan, perhaps maybe I should have mentioned this first, and that is running out painstakingly careful cash flows. Most of our clients, again, I deal with a lot of sort of the wealthy, but most of our clients have not lived off a budget, which is why these cash flows are valuable, because basically what we're saying here is, here's how much money you have, here's how much money you spend,
right.
Here's how much money you make. Okay, and we run it out year by year, and we say, okay, well,
if you keep going this way, here's where you're going to wind up.
Based on everything, based on everything, and exactly how you're allocated and invested,
right?
This is our best, most accurate picture of what your future financial life will look at.
Right.
Now, the question then becomes, can we do better? Can we move some chess pieces around? Okay, is there enough liquidity perhaps to put more money in tax-deferred shells and have less tax on your portfolio?
Yeah.
Is there an opportunity here for some investment product or strategy that you're not utilizing? Okay. And we basically build out the most opportunistic cash flow, you know, deferring taxes as much as possible and creating risk avoidance on the portfolio.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, we help them to build that out.
Yeah.
Clients do not do this on their own.
I know. You know, I was going to say, I mean, I'm not going to say like that everyone's like me. You know, I might assume that or something. But if everyone is like me, I mean, or most, you know, would you say most don't operate on a budget?
Most people don't operate on a budget.
They don't, right?
They kind of
wing it.
They kind of wing it. You know, they gotten used to pretty much, you know, the gut feel for, you know, how much they can run up on the credit card.
Right.
But I think, you know, most of our clients really don't live off a budget per se. They don't really have good books and records as to what they spend.
Right.
But we help them to gauge that, by the way, so that we have a situation with our cash flows where it's not a garbage in, garbage out.
Yeah.
You know, we take a real good look at what the spending patterns, you know, including things like, you know, if you buy a new car every 5 years, it's all in there.
Yeah.
Or, you know, a home improvement every 5 years, whatever it may be, it's all in there. So you get to really see your future financial life. And then, again, the question is, how can we make that better? Other areas we look at is the college funding or education funding for children. You know, what are the most tax advantage ways to get there, but also taking a disciplined approach,
right?
You know, to getting there. Other areas we look at is benefits. You know, looking at your benefits elections at work, or if you're an entrepreneur or a business owner, you know, what benefits do you need to provide for yourself? For instance, things like disability or things of that nature, you know, health insurance, catastrophic health insurance. We also look at risk management. So insurance, how much insurance do you need? We calculate that out. It stems off the cash flow. What we do in the cash flow is we say, okay, this is if you both live happily ever after, you know, to age 90 or thereabouts. Now, this is if one of you dies tomorrow.
Right.
Okay. How much does the other need? Okay.
Right.
So what do you need in terms of life insurance? Or if you're...
You have kids and stuff.
Exactly. Especially, our clients are generally families.
Uh-huh.
You know, our clients usually aren't single individuals. They're families that want to be prepared for these events and want to have a good handle on all these contingencies. So, you know, we help our clients to determine what is the proper amount of insurance, what is the proper types of insurance. The insurance world is filled with, you know, both horrible and very good products are out there.
Mm-hmm.
What is the right type of insurance and right amounts of coverage?
Okay? Yeah.
So we help our clients sort through all that, and then investing, of course, taking a disciplined approach to investing, okay, which we had talked about, and then we do tax planning. You know, we look at past tax returns, and we're realizing that those CPAs are generally just computing tax liability, and then we say, well, okay, now going forward, you know, what can we do going forward to, you know, minimize taxes, whether it's more contributions into tax-deferred retirement plans or, you know, whatever the strategies may be, they're out there. They're
right.
Certainly out there. You know, we help our clients, you know, build out a, you know, more of income tax game plan and an investment tax game plan.
Yeah.
So they limit their tax liabilities.
Interesting. So to tell me if this is a good analogy. I mean, you are... You seem to be, from the way you're describing it, almost like the general contractor.
Yeah.
of your financial health.
Yes.
You know, utilizing the various, almost like a general contractor on your house would hire a plumber and electrician and a drywall guy and a whatever if you're building a house. Is that a good analogy to say, like, you know, building your financial future, you're looking at the legal, the insurance, you're looking at a lot more than I would have, would have expected.
It's a great analogy, and quite frankly, my profession sort of kind of didn't even exist 50 years ago.
Right, is this a new?
It's somewhat of a new profession.
Mm-hmm. Now, are you tied to certain companies that you represent in terms of the financial vehicles, or is it that you're wide open?
Well, funny you mention that. That's a really good question. And let me comment on, I think, five things that separates my platform from the rest.
Sure.
Okay. And we really operate in, I think, a specialized niche in that, you know, I kind of look over my shoulder and I guess the competition is anyone who has financial advice to give out. But I don't really see much direct competition. We're very unique. But the objectivity that we come to the table with in dealing with the product arena, okay, I think is second to none.
Mm-hmm.
We don't, you know, we're not making a market in stocks, okay? We're not wholesaling any products. We're not steering any business to any vendors where any employees of a firm might have an interest. We're not dealing with, added remuneration from vendors and deals. I mean, you go to the brokerage houses, you might wonder sometimes why, you know, they keep pitching the same stocks and the same mutual funds, you know, because, you know, they're in bed with a couple of fund families and they're incentivized.
Right.
You know, we don't, we basically work off a very objective platform to deal with the product arena. That's one thing that I would say is different.
Sure.
The second thing I'd say that's different about us is, you know, having this back office professional staff, you know, that covers, law, taxes, insurance, and investments, and can really drill down deep and get granular in terms of the strategic thinking and planning, I would say is certainly, a rare offering, okay?
Yeah.
The third thing I'd point to is our ability to do the four disciplines planning and also manage money, okay, where one isn't necessarily a prerequisite than the other.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a trend that's going on in the business, and it's sort of an alarming trend, is a lot of the money managers out there say, give us your money and then we'll provide financial planning for you, and most of the time what they're doing is they're subbing out the planning to some small CPA firm who's crunching out some numbers.
Okay, so let me just stop you there.
Yeah,
you said there's five pillars, so to speak, of what makes you different.
That's three.
We have that was three. Okay. Yeah, that was three of the five. So objective, the staff, and
objectivity on products, having that back office professional staff.
And what's the third one?
The third one is the ability to manage money and do the planning. in one sort of cohesive platform without one being necessarily a prerequisite for the other.
Gotcha, gotcha. Okay. So we have a caller on hold.
Yep.
John O'Brien has a question. John, you there? Good, good. How are you? What's your question for Kevin?
Well, I think that the first of all, you have to realize the 529 plans are tax advantageous. Secondly, with four children, realize that you can move those funds around from child to child. You're not confined to one child versus the other. So, you know, my general thinking would be I certainly wouldn't pull mutual funds out of a 529 plan to invest in other funds. You know, and then you'd suffer a tax hit, of course. So I don't think that really makes a lot of sense. You can switch if you're unhappy with the 529 program you're in. Most people don't know that you can switch from, let's say, one vendor or one state's program to another.
Okay. Yeah. We're going to pause that. Hey, John, if you can hold on, we want to continue answering your question after the break. Again, it's Greg from Greg Ricardi, My Favorite Show, here with Kevin Rex from Summit Financial. We'll see you in a couple minutes. John, hang on the phone. And welcome back to My Favorite Show. I'm Greg Ricardi here. Dr. Cole is on a very well-needed break. He's at the municipal court right now, fighting over some tickets. But we are privileged enough to have Kevin Rex here of Summit Financial having a very interesting conversation about all things financially related. Want to remind you that we have a website associated with our show, myfavoriteshow.com. Feel free to go there, sign up. You get email alerts, you get text reminders about the next show coming up. It's, you know, it's kind of cool. Also, we're videotaping every show, every episode here, so you can watch this one and any one we've done in the past on the website as well. So getting back to John O'Brien's question, I think did we lose John? We lost John. Okay, so John has two sets of twins. The question he asked was, what was the specific?
Well, he was saying, should he perhaps pull money out of his 529 plans
to
get more aggressive, maybe to invest in a mutual fund that he had in mind.
Okay.
But you realize that once you pull money out of the structure of a 529 plan,
Put it back.
You can't put it back, and you also have a 10% penalty because it wasn't used for education.
Correct.
Okay,
right.
So you know, tax penalty. That doesn't make a whole lot of sense. And what I was saying to him is, you're not confined to the original 529 plan you invested. You can move from state plan to state plan. So if it was something about his plan, he wasn't happy with the investments, he would have the choice to move it to one of the other state's plans.
Oh, so the 529 is designated to a state? It's not like a company or something?
Well, kind of the opposite. You can invest in any state. It doesn't really matter.
Interesting.
It doesn't matter where you live or where the child goes to school.
Gotcha.
You pretty much can live anywhere globally so long as you're a U.S. taxpayer.
Gotcha.
You could invest in any one of the state's plans.
I see.
And the child can go to school globally.
Wherever they want to go.
Yeah.
So, some states' plans doing better than others?
Oh, absolutely.
Really? Yeah, what would you say are the more popular ones now, or if you can,
Yeah, Virginia.
Really?
New Hampshire. Alaska has a great plan, but it's a little pricey. When I was talking before about underlying expenses, you got to be a little careful with that plan. It's a little pricey. New York's not bad. They have two different plans. New York's pretty good. Depending on what you're looking for, in the plan. Some are a little better at bonds. Some are a little lower cost. Some are, better equities selection. So
sure.
Depends on what you're looking for. If your child was 1 year old and you have a long time frame, program that gives you robust equity selections would probably be a good way to go.
Gotcha. I mean, this guy, John O'Brien, he's got two sets of twins.
Yeah.
So I don't care if they're 1 and 3 right now, or 11 and 13. He's gonna get.
He needs the plan.
Yeah.
He needs the plan because you certainly don't want to be stuck with four tuitions at the same time. Yeah, that can be brutal.
I've got twins that are 15 right now.
Okay.
And, boy, girl, and I'm 2 years away from,
one or two vehicles, insurance on it.
And then, of course, the education. So I'd ask you, some advice for myself, but I'm shot. No. I'm okay. So where else should we go? Let me ask you, what would, how does the new laws that are changing and stuff affect things in general? I mean, we had the crash, you know, 2008 and stuff. The government instituted, from what I understand as a layperson, instituted all these new restrictions and things. How does that affect someone's ability? Are there just as many opportunities? Are there just as many loopholes? Are there just as many, you know, or is it like much more difficult to invest for, you know, these days? Is it?
Well, let's say this. The paperwork is voluminous.
I see.
You know, with the...
it's a lot of red tape.
Yeah, there's a lot of paperwork to get an investment transaction done. If you go back 10 years ago and you look at today, you know, the amount of paper and the size of the file, you know, has tripled. You know, you need, you know, all forms of ID. I mean, things just didn't exist, you know, 10 or 15 years ago. So, I mean, to that extent, you know, let's just say it's just a little harder or slower getting things done.
Oh, I see. So
but it's not. Yeah, it's not like opportunities went away or...
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, in fact, if anything, I'd say there's been a bit of a cleansing. So, you know, those less than savory investments people who were touting, you know, scam products or you weren't following the rules have been... somewhat driven out of town.
Yeah.
You know.
Gotcha.
Because, yeah, there's been a tougher age of regulation right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And when you say cleansing, is that like cleansing the bad?
Well, yeah, I mean... The
people out, or...?
Yeah, I mean, the regulatory authorities have gotten a lot more aggressive. They show up at your doorstep more often. They roll their sleeves up and get a whole lot more granular than they used to.
Yeah.
And, you know, what they're trying to do is, again, cleanse the business of people who don't follow the rules or people who are just absolutely unscrupulous.
Yeah.
You know, so there's been a lot of that going on. In the meantime, though, the amount of paperwork to do a transaction has unquestionably
increased.
Gotcha.
Listen, before the break, we were talking about the five pillars. One was objective, the second one was your staff, and then the third was the plan.
Yeah.
Right? Give us the other two. We don't want to...
Sure. Okay. The fourth is the... technology platform. I think our technology platform is just absolute cutting edge. We have you know, custom designed software. We have...
Oh, really?
Yeah, we stay on the cutting edge of our offering. We're at the right size, Greg, for giving the client a technology offering that's robust. We have an ample budget for technology. We have a commitment to technology. But we're not so big where the bureaucracy would stand in the way. Imagine if you were at one of the big banks and you saw something in the world of personal finance and you went back. You'd have to, first of all, convince the higher-ups that you need it.
As a client or as an employee?
No, let's say you were an advisor.
Yeah,
and you saw something out there in the world of technology that you don't have.
And
you'd have to convince the higher-ups that you need it.
Right.
And that would take years to get it through.
I could imagine.
You know, at our firm, you know, something like that could take as little as weeks, if not months. But, you know, it most likely won't take years to get it done.
Now, honestly, the whole technology thing is a little surprising. I mean, what can you employ or deploy, I guess, inside your castle walls, so to speak, that someone else can't? I mean, what program could you write or software thing, like, you know, give me an idea of what some of the technology is.
Well, it's technology that crunches out the numbers and cash flows. I mean, for instance, imagine a technology platform where you plug in one number.
Yeah.
And that number is the assumption for the growth of all your assets.
Mm-hmm.
And you plug in just one tax rate for life, and it's not dynamic, doesn't change.
I see. So
now, when you retire, your tax rate is going to change.
Yeah,
okay?
Right.
So, you know, I'm talking about software that'll say, okay, well, we're going to change the tax rate for different ages,
right,
different years.
I got you.
Okay.
Or so is it building like models based on?
Yeah.
Okay. I got you.
And we're gonna change the growth rate on your assets.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, as you go along, so much more of an accurate picture of real life. Okay. Versus, again, a lot of this software you would see over the internet, you're plugging in one number. You're saying, okay, if my assets went up 5%. And if my tax rate were 30%, okay,
what's the outcome?
That's the outcome. But
ignoring a million other factors that...
Exactly.
Software. So what would be, I mean, of course not a plug, but like what would be one of these software things that you can get online? Is it Quicken or something? Like what?
It's most of what's online. I can't even at this point, because I absolutely don't use them.
Yeah, right.
I can't even, think of the names.
I see.
Yeah, but it's most of what's online.
All right, gotcha.
Yeah.
Give me the last one. The
last one is our ability to do interstate planning,
mm-hmm.
and provincial planning and international planning. We have not only some good people in-house that know their way around, but certainly, more importantly, we have a huge strategic alliance network where we can make phone calls to other professionals who deal in these local jurisdictions.
Now, why would someone, or give me an example of someone who would need that,
It's a huge part of my personal practice.
I see.
And that's dealing with the expatriate community.
Okay.
So I have clients all over the world, Greg.
Right.
So I'm dealing with clients in, in London, in Madrid, in Italy, you name it, they have their local, obviously their national rules, and then they have their local rules.
Right.
Okay. We would work with the treaties, the Home Office. So we would look at the treaties and make sure we're following the treaty. Okay. But we would also work with local professionals on the ground in those jurisdictions, such that we're not missing a trick.
Right. Okay. Right.
So as we do the planning, we want to make sure that I's are dotted and T's are crossed, and we have this huge strategic alliance of best-of-breed law firms, accounting firms, financial planning folks, product folks, that, we can pick their brain, they can pick our brain, we can drill down deep. It's not even necessarily billable time to the client. Sometimes it is, most of the times it's not.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And, these are alliances, these are professional friends that we have overseas where we work with each other. They'll ask us questions, we'll ask them, but it works quite nicely.
Yeah. So quick question. You mentioned expatriates. I mean, are these people that their job brings them all over the world?
Yeah.
Or, okay.
Yeah. Well, I mean, an opportunity that I recognized roughly about 15 years ago. I'm with Summit now. I believe something like 27 years, but about 15 years ago, I realized that there's a huge expat community as the world globalizes.
Right.
A lot of Americans with know-how were asked to build up divisions and run businesses overseas.
I could see that, yeah.
So I had a client, fly me over a few times, and, well, long story short, I realized there was this huge
market
network of
there.
Americans, this huge market.
Absolutely.
And they're abandoned. They have no place to turn for advice.
Yeah. All right, I'll give you 20 seconds. Why do you do what you do?
Oh, I love what I do. Why do I do what I do? I'm helping people and getting paid to do that. That's just a beautiful combination.
Excellent. So, folks, we've been speaking with Kevin Rex of Summit Financial. You can reach him at summitfinancial.com or call his office, 973-285-3600. And that's it. Make sure you log on to myfavoriteshow.com to watch the awesome video that we shot here today. And that's it. Thanks for listening, folks. We'll see you next time on My Favorite Show. Thanks so much.
You've been listening to My Favorite Show, where Dr. Richard Call and Greg Riccardi discuss the matters that matter most. My Favorite Show is taped live Monday nights at 7 p.m. To watch the video of this broadcast in the WVNJ studio, visit myfavoriteshow.com.